Aho. Alright, this is Miguel, aka Talaco, coming to bring some good medicine to our native community. Native people look different back in the day than we do today. Look at Chief Joseph, Hung Papa Sue. Alright, take a look at Chief Joseph, Nez Perce. Okay, look at the differences in each man as we go through. Now, take a look at Chief Lone Wolf from the Kiowa Nation. See, each man has a different look, different features. Alright? Okay, stay tuned. Alright, let's go take a look right here at Chief Two Moons from the Cheyenne Nation. Alright? Again, each nation, a different look. A different look. Let's take a look at this proud Blackfoot chief right here. I don't have his name, but he's representing in a good way, bringing good medicine to the people. In Thomas Jefferson's notes from the 1780s, he spoke about the Mattaponi Indians there, and he said that they look more Negro than black. Native American culture has always been a different look. Look at this native right here with a strong white mix. I don't know his nation or name. Alright. Now take a look at this young native right here with seemingly equal part mixtures of black, native, and white. Okay. Look at this native right here. With seemingly equal strong parts of black and native in his appearance. See, we all look different. And take a look at this native right here with a seemingly strong Mexican Indian look. Do you see that, mi gente? Alright. Now take a look at this native right here. An Oklahoma Chata, who has seemingly strong white and native mixtures in his features. The thing about it, native who has seemingly strong white and native mixtures in his features. The thing about it, Native American people, we have always had different looks. And today, because of the strong mixtures, because of over history, we know that we were invaded by Europeans. And so a lot of our women were raped, and there were a lot of mixtures between black and native people, not only through slave times when slaves escaped, but also before the whites came and settled. There were free blacks already living here that had mixed in with the natives. So before slavery, after slavery, the bloodlines have been mixing all this time. And even today, depending on largely what part of the United States you're in, and I've said this for years, you have different looks. If you go out in the plains, a lot of the natives out there, you know, on the Lakota and Cheyenne, have strong white features, you know, because of the mixing and intermarriages and things like that out there. Some by force, some by choice, just really depends, you know, each family situation as it is. If you go into the southeast portion of the United States, you see a lot of dark native people, heavy black admixture. If you go to the southwest, you see a lot of natives with strong Mexican admixtures, okay? You go along the eastern seaboard, you see a good mix of dark natives and white natives. You go along the top, along the Canadian and upper part of the United States in there, you know, upper states, you see a lot of white fair skin admixtures, you know. Just really kind of depends on what part of the country you're in. But what I'm trying to share here is that Native people today, we are really an ethnic group in the same way that Latinos are. You can find a Latino person, a black, white, Native American mixture, and all of them can have different looks. They can be very, very white, to very brown, to very yellow, to very, very chocolate dark. And that's the same thing. So there is no one look for a Native American. I will ask you, if you believe that, will you tell me, based on what you just saw, what does a Native American look like? If people want to say then it's not true that none of these people are Native because they aren't pure blood anymore, and there are just a few, you know, remnants of Native people that no longer live on, that still live on reses. Most Native people today are non-reservation Indians, and particularly, you know, back before the government came in with all this Dawes Rule and all of these different things, you know, all of our people lived together in our own communities, our own tribes and clans and bands and all those things. But when the government came in and started taking, you know, census and counting and all that, they determined who they felt was Native and who wasn't. And those that were darker, that couldn't pass the paper bag test. If you were darker than a paper bag, they couldn't get a comb through your hair. Well, stupid things like that. People were separated, exonerated from their families. And oh, mi gente. All right. This is part three, and this is, for now, the final installment on Native Americans of blood so mixed. So basically, just to get to the wrap-up of this mini-series, what I was talking about on part two was that when the government came in with the different commissions and Dawes Rule and all the things like that, what they did, they went into Native American areas and communities, and they began to separate the people. And any natives there that were with their families that were dark, that couldn't pass the paper bag test. The paper bag test, basically, if you were darker than a paper bag, you weren't Native. And if they couldn't get a comb through your hair, you weren't Native. They were considered black or mulatto. So you basically were removed from your people. So what happened, in many cases, you had people that were put out of their nations and could never go back to see their people, and their people couldn't come to see them because people were pretty much trapped on the reservations. So you have families that never saw one another again. It's just the saddest thing how the government came in and broke up families. As I said, you had mixed blood natives that were already here before the European invasion. That, again, referencing back to what Thomas Jefferson said in his Notes on Virginia from 1783, and during that time period, he talked about the Mattaponi Indians in Virginia, and he talked about how that the Mattaponi Indians looked more Negro than Indian. The blood had already been mixed in from free blacks that were, again, already here, but that's a whole other video. You can look that up, and you can read a great book about that, They Came Before Columbus, by Ivan Van Sertima, I believe it is. And you can also read about that in a great book called When Nations Gather, by Sultan Latif. I may not be saying the name quite right, but you could Google it. Very good book on this subject. Alright, so let me go forward. And in the Oklahoma area, you have a lot of black towns that sprang up because these people were put out of their nation. So they had to basically go on and just assume a black identity, learn to live all over again. It was just really hard and horrendous, you know, what happened. Can you imagine not seeing your mother again, or your father, or your cousin, or your sister or brother, you know, because, you know, the people are different complexion than you, so you all don't see one another. It was really horrifying what was done to us. And to be Native in that time, you had no rights. You know, you couldn't vote, you couldn't own anything, and you couldn't testify in court unless a white person represented you. It was just really awful. Native people didn't get to be members of the United States or citizens, I think it was till like 1924. But back online with this video talking about mixed blood and Native American people and what do they look like today, we are a rainbow of people. That's why we carry that rainbow medicine, because we are still here, but we look like so many different things, but the blood is still there. And if you honor your ancestry and where you come from, that's the most important thing. Now, as it pertains to, there was something else that I wanted to share regarding this. Oh, yeah. And see, mi gente, this is why a lot of black native people have a lot of trouble, and some white natives too, depending on what state you live in. I know, I think it was in Virginia, the state government wiped out Native Americans from so much of the rolls, where they just said you were either black or white, you know. So they have a really hard battle out there unless things have changed, the way they went in and just did a lot of genocide on the records, erasing people's true ancestry, you know, and changing. That's just a nightmare. But for a lot of black Indian people in other places, you'll go back and try to research and pull records, and they'll just have black on there. You know, they were really, really trying to get rid of and minimalize Native people. It's just really terrible. And that's why a lot of times, if you go, even for your ancestors, say you are from any one of the five civilized tribes, you try to go back for some people and find relatives on the rolls, sometimes you will only find them on a freedman's roll, and they weren't even freedmen. They were actually, you know, native. Freedman meaning slave of that particular nation, you know, for those of you that are a little more savvy about what happened in the five civilized tribes with the slave owning and things like that. But that's a whole other video. But what I want to say, that's why a lot of black natives from those tribes in particular ran into roadblocks because of what they did on the records, which just makes it terrible to try to connect. That's why you have to, you know, like I say, talk to your family and get as many documentations, you know, videotape and have them talk, you know, the elders that still remember things. You know, try to get stories and try to piece together what you can, census records or whatever. But I won't go too far into that because I'm not trying to do a genealogy video. You know, maybe another time I can speak on that. What else I wanted to say is, and this is, I wanted to pick up, Chief, what you were talking about the media controlling image. It is so true. So what happens is, the people that win the war, they get to write the history. So what happens, you now have in reservations, you have Native people and then Native people that have been mixed with white. So those people are there continuing to learn the traditions. Your black Indian people have been displaced. So there are many, in many cases, many generations removed. So a lot of information has been lost. Language has been lost. All these different kind of things. So then you fast forward today, and they're making Hollywood makes movies about Indians and things like that. So they go grab the people on reservation. So when you go to see the movies, you go to look at Dances with Wolves, you go to look at Dreamcatcher on television, you're seeing very fair-skinned Native people, and that is not an accurate depiction of everybody that has Native American ancestry. We are all kinds of hues because of our mixing and because of the different parts of the country that we lived in. I don't know if I discussed this or not because I had a lot of editing problems on this video, but what I'll say really quickly, just depending on what part of the United States that you lived in is a huge determination on what you will look like. Shoot, Southwest United States, a lot of the natives down there have more of a Mexican Indian look because of that admixture. You go to the Southeast, you have a heavy dark admixture because of the black admixture down in the Southeast. You go along the Eastern Seaboard, you see a very good sprinkling and mixing of black and white appearing natives because of that admixture. You go along the top Canadian border, you know, of the United States, you see a more fair-skinned native populations and groups of peoples because of the white admixture, you know, French Canadian, different things like that. And then you go into the plains, you see very light-skinned natives for the most part because of the white admixture, you know, the soldiers and different things that happen out there on the plains. Also, right along with that, when you have these images, and that's all you see, that's all you think that a Native person looks like. That's why a lot of times, darker Natives catch a lot of flack. You know, even going to, I've been to powwows and things like that, and gotten a sideways look. You know what I'm saying? Like, who is this you know, this guy right here. You know, he's not our complexion. Now, if you look good, you can definitely see the features. You can definitely see hair texture. You know what I'm saying? I may not be swinging long ponies and things like that. But, you know what I'm saying? If I grow my hair, I probably could do that. But the point of it is, that's not what it's about. But Hollywood and the media have made it about those things. You see what I'm saying? Because they're controlling the images. And it's just really, really a sad thing. But let me say this. All right? Let me say this. People don't say that you're not fully black because you don't have a full blood African ancestor as your parent or grandparent. Most black Americans, if we just deal with that for a second, just to make a comparison, most black Americans don't have a full blood African ancestor for many generations, some for hundreds of years, all right? Because they have all different other sorts of, you know, admixtures, Native American, white, whatever, right? So you have the same thing in Native American culture. Are you sitting there? Are you really, seriously? Are you really trying to tell me that just because a person doesn't have a full blood Native ancestor as a parent or a grandparent, that diminishes their blood? I don't think so. I'm going to need you to find somebody else to go trick with that one. You know what I mean? So we are who our ancestors were. Be proud of that. Walk in that. You know what I'm saying? Know that. And let me say this to Native peoples that grew up traditionally. It is a great resource to have this beautiful rainbow tribe of mixed blood people. I'll tell you why. The reach is so much greater because we are out in the community. We're out amongst many different people. And the danger is, if people that are just content on only associating with those that grew up like they did, that know the old ways. For example, reservation Native elders. All right, let me talk to you guys for a moment, most respectfully. If you all do not share these sacred teachings and the old ways with those that are coming to seek the knowledge in a good way and respectfully, then if it's not taught, how will the people remember? And how will it go forward? And how will the information and the knowledge be here for ancestors to come? Our people in the old days, we all looked different then. And we still look different today. It's the same thing. History has repeated itself once again. So we can't let, because somebody may look different than what we think they should look like, stop us from sharing if they're coming in a good way. Because if the dominant culture, those that are disrespectful to our heritage, would have it their way, we'll just be a memory. I had someone to ask me, and it was a very innocent question, but it really made me think. And that was one of the other things that motivated me to do this little three-part series. They asked, where are the American Indians today? And I'm like, oh my God. I mean, we're still here. But it's like, you don't find a lot of people in mainstream media talking about it. And if they do, they want to put us in a historical context. They want the romantic version of natives. They want someone on the plains, on a horse, you know, riding behind a buffalo. Or they want you in the woods, you know, pulling out a bow and arrow. You know what I'm saying? We haven't lived that way in so long. You know what I'm saying? We drive cars. We ride motorcycles. We walk. We jog. We listen to music. You know, we eat all kinds of food, not just buffalo and venison. You know what I mean? So we're still here. We just have different faces today. But we had different faces back then and different hair textures back then. So let's not be fooled by this great deception that has come to divide our people. We're still here. And for those that's walking in a good way, let's share that knowledge and information respectfully with those who wish to receive it respectfully. We never know which ancestors to come are going to need this and who they will need to get that information from, because it is good medicine. I hope.